I give my hands to do your work, and Jesus, for I give them willingly. I give my feet to go your way, and every step I shall take cheerfully. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my strength, my strength. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my help, my help. For the power of His Spirit is in my heart, and the joy of the Lord is my strength. I give my eyes to see the world, and everyone is just the way you do. I give my tongue to speak your words, to spread your name and freedom giving through. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my strength, my strength. Oh, the joy of the Lord is my help, my help. For the power of His Spirit is in my heart, and the joy of the Lord is my strength.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
A hearty welcome to each one of you, my dear brothers and sisters, to this Eucharist. Once again, receiving the Lord in His Word, receiving the Lord spiritually, for all here present in the Eucharist. Because of the special circumstances, many, many of you cannot go to church, and therefore we become as one family around this altar over here in Holy Name Cathedral in the city of Mumbai. Let's begin the sacrifice, putting ourselves in God's presence, humbly asking His forgiveness for our sins. You were sent to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let's all together praise God now in the words of the Gloria.
To people of good will, we praise you.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Kindly sit for the readings.
A reading from the book of Nehemiah. In those days, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, both men and women, and all who could understand what they heard, on the first day of the seventh month. And he read from it facing the square before the water gate from early morning until midnight, in the presence of the men and the women, and those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood on a wooden platform that they had made for the purpose. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people, and as he opened it, all the people stood. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. And Ezra and the Levites read from the book, from the law of God clearly, and they gave the meaning, so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go on your way, eat the fat and drink sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready, for this day is holy to our Lord. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response to the psalm is,
trustworthy, giving wisdom to the simple. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brethren, just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. Now you are the body of Christ, and individually members of it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Kindly stand for the Gospel.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things that you have been taught. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee. And the report about him went through all the surrounding country. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. As was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus, this is the year of Luke. I mentioned that to you before, said that there's a three-year cycle, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and this is year C, the third year, and this is the year called, they call it the year of Luke, because on Sundays, the gospel is taken from St. Luke. As you know, there are four evangelists, four who have written. There are many others, but not approved by the church, not officially sanctioned by the church as canonical, as inspired writings, as the four Gospels are, the whole New Testament, 27 books. And the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, were written by four inspired authors to tell us about Jesus. That's why we read it over here every Sunday. And from today, last Sunday was John, and then the previous Sundays were special feasts. From today onwards, we begin hearing, and every Sunday till the end of the year, almost every Sunday, because sometimes some feasts come in between, we hear the Gospel of Luke. And Luke, today, we begin from the very first verse of the first chapter, where Luke says, many people have written, I've studied this matter now, and I think I should write for you in a very orderly manner to you, Theophilus. Theophilus is lover of God, and therefore he's addressing it to each one of us, to each one here who has listened to the gospel, written it for us, for you, for me, and in an orderly fashion, that we know what exactly happened. This Gospel of Luke was written for the third generation Christians or Catholics, in the sense that first generation was those who were with Jesus, then one more generation. This was written about the year estimated 70 or 80, about a little under 50 years after our Lord had died. And therefore is now the third generation Christians. For them, he's writing an account of what happened about Jesus. And after this first introduction, he goes straight to the gospel passage, chapter 4. In a way, my sisters and brothers, this is a continuation of this manifestation. I mentioned to you that at Christmas, Jesus comes in the world, is manifested over there. We have the Feast of the Epiphany, where again he's manifested to the kings, not just the Jews, it's kings who have come from the East. That's why the Orthodox celebrate it as much as Christmas, the Feast of the Epiphany. For them, that is Christmas, really. And then we have the Feast of the Baptism of our Lord. Once again, a manifestation to the world. The heavens are opened. The dove descends on Jesus. We hear the voice of the Father. This is my beloved Son, manifested to the whole world and to the surrounding people. John the Baptist, etc. And today, we once again, if you look at it deeply, there is a manifestation today too. Jesus is manifesting himself to the assembled crowd. He comes to Nazareth, his hometown, to to the synagogue. What is a synagogue? Synagogues are halls, sort of, where they would have these regular services. There was only one temple. Temple was in Jerusalem. And synagogues were all over. Every village, every town would have a synagogue, a hall where they would get together and pray. No sacrifice was offered. The sacrifice was offered in the temple. Again, symbolizing the unity, only one God. And therefore, the sacrifice had to be in one place to the one God. Other places they came. Now, in the synagogues, it was a custom that they would meet on the Sabbath. I've seen some synagogues in the Holy Land, and we've got also in our own cities, and even in Mumbai, there are synagogues. And then you come over there, and the practice of our Lord's time, I don't know how it is now, if it's been developed further, was there would be a prayer, somebody would be invited from the congregation to read from the scriptures, then there would be an explanation, and then finally concluding prayer or a blessing. It could be anybody who would read the scriptures, need not necessarily being from the priestly tribe. And so Jesus had his custom. He was following the Jewish customs like a devout Jew trained by his mother and father. And he comes to his own hometown of Nazareth. And then he takes is given the scroll of the book of Isaiah, written several hundred years before our Lord, the book of Isaiah. And here, there were no books that time, there were scrolls, no? So he opens the scroll and he reads this passage from chapter 61 of Isaiah. What we heard in the gospel, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He had just received his baptism, and therefore the Spirit had come upon him. Spirit of the Lord, and he has sent me to proclaim the good news to the poor, to release captives, the prisoners. He has sent me to give sight to the blind and to transform the world. Now these four things which he's got, the poor, proclaim sight, give liberty, to give freedom and hope for the oppressed, downtrodden, are like the inauguration of Jesus' ministry. And Jesus says, this has been done. He sits down, you notice he stands up like as we stand up for the gospel when he reads the scriptures, and he sat down to give the homily, and he began by saying, this scripture has been fulfilled. What is said here is being done. The message is, the Messiah has come. This was a prophecy, Messiah has come, and this is what he has got to do. This is then the mission statement, as it were, of our Lord, what he has got to do. The poor, the prisoners, the blind, the oppressed, to proclaim a year of the Lord's favor, to proclaim completely, now we are going to focus on this. And as we reflect, sisters and brothers, I was reflecting, our Lord came to give good news to the poor. Lord came to free prisoners. Our Lord came really to give sight to the blind. Our Lord came to give justice to the oppressed. 2,000 years ago, as we see the world today, has our Lord really succeeded? There are the poor still with us. They tell us in the pandemic, the poor people have become poorer. There are prisoners still with us. Not everybody's freed from them. As we look around today, there are still people who are blind. As we look around today, there are people still who are oppressed. Why our Lord did not succeed fully? He certainly did fulfill his mission by dying on the cross. And as we pray and reflect, we realize there still is poverty, there still is blindness, there still are prisoners, people oppressed, because we, who are the body of Jesus, as we hear in the second reading from St. Paul to the Corinthians, have not done our task. There are poor, but there's different types of poverty, not just material poverty. Poverty of those who are lonely. Poverty of those who are suffering for different sicknesses, isolated. Poverty of those who do not know how to relate to people. Poverty of those who are cut off for different reasons. And this is the poverty that Jesus also came to relieve. He certainly also wanted to alleviate the difficulty. But the primary poverty was this poverty, the spiritual poverty. There were prisoners, not just in our state prison, that's not the primary thing. Prisoners of the prejudice, prisoners of hatred, prisoners of their own habits, vices, prisoners of our own attitudes. And death has got to be cured. Jesus preached, taught, gave example. We are the church, St. Paul says. What have we done for that? There are people who are blind, not physical blindness, spiritual blind, don't see what they're doing, don't see the sufferings of others, don't see suffering of themselves, their own weaknesses, don't see the truth about Jesus Christ. What have we done about that? There are people who are oppressed in different ways, not just by society. We know in our own country, the Dalits, people who are outsiders, people who are treated unfairly because of their origin of place, the migrants. What have we done about it? Jesus taught us the tremendous principles which would bring equality, justice, sight, freedom. And so we were thinking of Jesus' commission and our own commission. As Jesus had a mission given by the Father, which he fulfilled by his passion, by his life, passion, death and resurrection, each one of us, my sisters and brothers, every individual is great in the eyes of God. No one is small, you and I. And each one of us has a mission. Each one has the same mission as Jesus. If we are part of Jesus, we have the same mission. Poverty, prisoners, blindness, oppression, to take it away, transform the world. Today, as we celebrate this third day, the year of the Word of God also, we try to examine what we have done, what we can to do. As we receive the Lord in the Word, let's ask Him to strengthen us. As we receive Him in our spiritual communion, ask Him to strengthen us. First of all, to see the truth, the need, to see our responsibility and to act on it. The first reading, sisters and brothers, was from the book of Nehemiah, where they read the Word of God. That's why today is a Sunday of the Word proclaimed by Pope Francis for all churches. And you see, if you hear what was the first reading, the priest Ezra stood up, read the scriptures like we do. We stood for the gospel. This was the Old Testament that time. They all stood up. And he read from daybreak till afternoon. Several hours, people were standing, people were crying, as we read in the book, and they shouted, Amen, Amen, as we say, praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And I was thinking, my sisters and brothers, how similar what they did in the synagogue is part of our first liturgy of the word, first part. We hear the word of God, and they said, Amen, Amen, and they were crying. Are we open to the word of God? Do we listen to it? The second part, the sacrifice offered in Jerusalem, is that like the second part of our Mass, where you have the liturgy of the Eucharist. The word of God is the presence of God. Jesus in the Gospel says, this is what the word of God says. He read it to us, and in effect he was saying, I am the word of God. I am fulfilling the word of God. As we hear scriptures, we need to hear it, listen to it with our eyes, with our ears, with our hearts, with our persons. Listen to it with our mind after we listen to it with our ears. Understanding what it means, understanding the background, the context, what the words mean. Listen to it again with our hearts, trying to love it, appreciate it, and then see what it means for us. Listen to it with our whole persons, to going out and living what the gospel, what the scriptures tell of us. We've got to begin to love the word of God, be transformed with the word of God, and go out to transform the world. This is our calling. On the Sunday of the word, let us resolve that the gospels, the readings of the Old Testament will not remain just a Bible on our shelves or on a place of honor in the house, but something which we will continuously, every day, every week, refer to, read, allow ourselves to be transformed. May we also make it our mission, as a continuation of Jesus, to be people who will give the good news to the poor, bring joy, the good news that God loves them, God brings freedom to them, to the poor, the needy. Let us also be people who will give liberty to prisoners, people who are tied up, stuck, tied down to their prejudice. We will help to remove them. Pray that we will give also sight to the blind, people who are uneducated, don't understand, don't see, help them to see. And help also the downtrodden free, people who are suffering, help to remove this. May we, as continuation of Jesus, also be transformers of the world, other Jesuses as the church should be, other Jesuses to all people. God bless each one of you. Let us now, my brothers and sisters, respond to God's call by saying, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He went down to the dead. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters, God is a God of mercy and compassion. Trusting in his fatherly love and care, let us now pray with faith, with love, with hope for all our needs and the needs of the church, the needs of the world.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. all together.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, our Archbishop Oswald Cardinal Gracias, for all our bishops, priests, religious, and lay leaders, that they may continue to be guided by God's word to lead the people of God to experience His love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all political and government leaders, that they may show special concern for those who are suffering hardship and deprivation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all lay ministers of the word, that rooted in the word of God, they may, through their teaching, renew the faith of those who listen and encourage them to trust in the promises of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all Christian families, that they may be rooted in the word of God in their homes and understand the greatness of God's power for all who believe in Him. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Christian unity, that all of us Christians be conscious of our responsibility as Christ followers to work for unity and peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our personal needs, that they may be answered according to God's will. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Ever-loving God, we thank you for calling us to be in your great family. Take away from our hearts whatever divides us from others. May we remember always that Christ died for all, that no one is excluded from your love. Make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, through goodness with this bread which we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in his divinity, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine which we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Lord God, we ask you to be pleased, receive the sacrifice we offer you, with humble and contrite hearts. Lord, wash away my sins, cleanse me from my iniquity. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that your sacrifice and mine may be acceptable to God, our Father in heaven.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death. By rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. So with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dew fall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be brought together in unity by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, the auxiliary bishops, Savio, John, Alvin, Barthol, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coerced to eternal life, praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers, we are one family, all disciples of Jesus, sons of Eternal Father. Let's pray the prayer Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, safe from all distress, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer you the sign of peace. Christ's peace be with you. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
May the mingling of this body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive him. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
We now make our spiritual communion with the Lord. O Lord Jesus, since I cannot now receive you in your sacramental presence, I beg you to come spiritually into my soul, to enrich me with your holy grace, and make me truly your own forever. O Jesus, living in Mary, come and live in me, in the spirit of your holiness, in the fullness of your power, in the communion of your mysteries, in the perfection of your ways. O divine guest, give to my soul a strong, lively faith, an unbounded trust, perfect humility, an abiding sorrow for my sins, a total abandonment to your divine will, and a perfect loving union with you in mind and heart. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. Lord Jesus, thank you for the blessings and graces you have given me through this spiritual communion.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
God bless each one of you. Have a lovely Sunday. And I'll see you, several of you, this evening for the question and answer session and the benediction. God bless you. Keep well. We pray for each other.
Prayer for relief from the coronavirus. Almighty and merciful God, who show your love to all creation everywhere, hear graciously the prayers we make for all those affected by the coronavirus in various parts of the world. We come before you asking for an efficacious control of the outbreak, for a healing of those affected, for the victims and their families. We thank you for blessing the efforts of our research scientists working on the development of a vaccine. We pray that these vaccines will be effective in combating the virus and its mutants and in controlling the spread of the pandemic and be available to all. We pray for doctors, nurses, and health workers who are in the front line of this battle, that they be kept safe and have the strength and courage to continue their heroic efforts. We pray for the government and health authorities that they take appropriate steps for the good of the people. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let the dove roll in.